We developers often model systems with entities and their relationships. This works great for small systems, but as they grow and entity relationships get more complex, it's easy for a system to get messy and difficult to understand. We want our models to be simple and concise, but the real world doesn't have one simple, unified model for everything. Naturally, the language we speak assumes a lot of context. Let's say you have a support or a help system on your website. A customer might raise a ticket and then they find they need to log into their account. But what if your business is a train booking system? Whilst you still have this support page, customers wanting to catch a train want to buy a ticket with money from their account. Or, even more complicated, passengers are directed to an area called a platform, which is how we split the station into several numbered areas. But some staff, such as maintenance, will further subdivide those areas into spaces such as the shops, cafes, and then the area where the passengers stand, the platform. There might even be a single platform that spreads across many platforms. See, in spoken language, we would automatically understand what these words mean by the context they're used in. But in code, these complexities can make a system quite difficult to work with. We can make our programming language work like our spoken language by separating code into these contexts. We define areas where the code can use a different model to solve different problems. This is called a bounded context. It's a part of the software where particular terms, rules, and definitions apply consistently. So when we're in one bit of the system, the platform refers to one thing, and when we're in another bit, the platform means a slightly different thing. Sometimes the same object exists in multiple models, but with different properties to interact with. And sometimes the same object exists, but it's referred to by a different term. Working out where to draw these boundaries in a software solution can be very difficult. One technique is to draw a context map, showing the language used around an organization, and then find subdomains like these, and separate out a bounded context for each subdomain. There are a few different types of subdomains. A core domain is what makes the organization special. It's a bit that gives you a competitive advantage. Whilst being perhaps a small amount of the overall system, this is where the vast majority of your business effort should go. Areas that aren't quite that unique special ingredient to the business but still require some specialized skills are called supporting subdomains. Maybe we can outsource these or at least put less effort into them. Then there are areas that many other businesses are doing as well. For example, those support tickets from earlier or invoicing or email marketing. These are called generic subdomains. For these areas, we can most likely just purchase third-party off-the-shelf tools. Those third-party tools will use their own model and language. This is a great example of a bounded context. Our colleagues that work with these tools daily may even use this language when discussing problems in their area. For example, the marketing department might call it an email campaign because that's what the third-party email service calls it. In this case, when we integrate with this other context, we might just want to conform to that model and use its language whenever we need to talk about a relationship to these solutions in a different context. But there might be other bounded contexts that we don't want polluting our system. For example, we need to integrate with an old legacy system, but we don't want to continue using the same legacy model everywhere. In this case, between the integration points, we can create a layer that translates from the old language to the new. This is called an anti-corruption layer. It ensures that one language doesn't corrupt the model of the other. There are other possible relationships. Two bounded contexts might share a subset of their model called a shared kernel, which could be a shared library or a component. The trade-off is that whilst we've reduced the duplication of the code, we need to be more careful designing the kernel itself. Another example is when one context depends on another and brings in its language, but instead of conforming, it could be a customer-supplier relationship or a partnership where the downstream context influences or even dictates what the supplier model looks like.